right. Today's message from our pastor Lee is called Walk the Talk. All right. Hello, everyone. Wow, it's been a long time. It's been 2 weeks ago now that I had car trouble. I arrived, but I was late. So we had to use John's message. And then last week, we were at the hospital with Mom. She's better now. She's better now. We're very thankful to the Lord for that. And I think it's just because Mom doesn't want to cook. So she had herself sent to the hospital so she could get her meals. Mom does not agree. She's signing. Yeah, that's real funny to me. So I'm probably in trouble with Mom now, but oh well, it wouldn't be the first time. Anyway, she's better. We're very thankful that she's feeling better. And we really appreciate all of your prayers for her. And we could feel you praying as she improved. Tomorrow is a special day for someone. Who is it? It's Jerry's birthday tomorrow.
Happy
60 years old.
Yeah. He said
70. Oh, 70?
He said
17. Oh, 17. I couldn't see from there. Actually, 71. So we want to sing you, sign you
happy birthday to you.
Thanks, everyone. Jerry says. So, a happy birthday to Jerry. Hope you have a great day, and we really appreciate your great faithfulness in attending church. And honestly, Jerry really reminds me of my dad. Truly, he does. They are a lot alike. Really a lot alike. Dad enjoyed having a good time. He enjoyed teasing people and having a lot of fun. And Jerry's like that as well. It really, really puts me in mind. Sniffle of my father who has gone on to his reward. So, walk the talk is the subject of today's message. What does that mean? Okay, so we have some guesses. You know, maybe it has to do with the 12 disciples. Walking and talking at the same time. Okay. Well, this title is really kind of a hearing title. It's, you know, not very deaf friendly. But what it really refers to is a hearing saying that says you need to walk the talk, meaning your actions need to fit your words and your the things you say. Many years ago, I was going to church in Georgia growing up, and we had a young pastor come. He was new,
a youth pastor.
He had so many ideas. He was bursting with ideas. People thought that was me. They were impressed with all of his cool ideas that he was able to put out there. But 1 month went by, 2 months, 3 months, and his ideas were still ideas. Nothing had happened. nothing had been put into to play, you know, and he just kept saying, I'm working on it. And, you know, time went by and still nothing happened. You know, he had great ideas. We had great expectations of him doing a great job. You know, we had, you know, a church with many young people. And he had great ideas for them, but nothing happened to really go out there and impact the young people in our church. So, I don't know, maybe, I don't know, a few years later he left and went to some other church. I don't know what happened to him after that. He was a good idea man, but not so great on the follow through. And we all know people who can talk the good talk. You know, they've always got big ideas, big things to say, but they're not so great with the follow through. And that's what this saying, walk the talk, really means. That your assertions, your talk, needs to match your actions. And today we're going to learn that Jesus's talk really fit his life, the way he lived. You know, Jesus didn't talk just like to hear himself talk. His words were very on point, and he really followed through specifically with the things that he said he would do. So our verse today is from the book of John, chapter 10, verses 22 through 23. The Lord's word says, we see that it was time for the festival holiday, the festival of dedication in Jerusalem. This was during the winter, and Jesus had gone to the temple courts and was walking in Solomon's colonnade, which was a row of columns that had that were supporting a roof overhead. Was an area to walk and think. People kind of were milling around. It was kind of an area to socialize. And the Jews who had gathered in that area were saying to him, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. You know, they were questioning him and really trying to push him to go ahead and, you know, stand up on, you know, a table somewhere and announce, I'm the Messiah, for everyone to hear. Because they had been waiting. So what do you think about that? God shows up. He's right here. You think he'd make it should make it easy for us to believe? That's not what he did. We would like that, but we would like to just have some bold announcement, but Jesus didn't do that. Jesus continued in faith to his Father because he knew his Father in heaven had a plan. Jesus wanted people to see his life and his actions and understand through his actions who he was. So Jesus just ignored people, continued to help people in need, continued to teach God's word. He wanted people to figure it out for themselves. Oh, I see. He is the Messiah. Do you remember back in school, maybe maybe math class. Imagine it's math class. And you, who liked math? Show of hands. Some yes, some no. Kind of a mixed group. Okay, okay. Well, one of my kids, I won't say which one, but one of my children really struggles with math. It's really tough. And every evening, I'm explaining math, trying to make sure they understand, and seems to understand. But then the next day, it's the same thing again, and I'm explaining the same thing again. But over time, as I continue to patiently explain it, the light bulb goes on. And it's like, finally, he or she's got it. But it takes a lot of consistent explaining, patiently, every day, knowing that for quite a while, it just seems like she'll never understand. But I can't force it. I can only offer to help. It's up to my child to understand it. And it takes a lot of work for my precious son or daughter to understand it for him or herself. Similarly, Jesus wants people to get it for themselves. You know, Jesus could, you know, go out and say, hey, look, here's the deal. I died on a cross. I rose again. Just make an announcement. But he wants people to see him living the gospel, to see him healing sick people, to see him helping people in need, socializing with people who are maybe a bit unlovable, you know, talking and associating with people rich and poor no matter what. That's the kind of person Christ is. It's the kind of person he wants us to be. He wants us to see his good works. So that fits his actions, his life, fits what he taught. And he wanted people to see that. To see that he was living out the life of the Son of God. So the Gospel of John continues by saying that Jesus simply answered, I did tell you, but you did not believe. Maybe Christ didn't specifically lay it out like in a list. This, 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 and this shows that I am the Son of God. But he said, I am the way and I am the life. And people look at him in confusion, like, what's that supposed to mean? He also said, I am the door. He said, he described himself as the door to God, the entrance. He said that. He said many things that should have turned on the light bulb in people's heads that he wasn't the Messiah. They didn't get it. They weren't thinking on it enough. Jesus told them, the works I do in my Father's name tell you about me. But you do not believe because you are not my sheep. It means that, what does he mean by you are not my sheep? It means that you are not, you don't belong to Jesus. You have not believed in who he is. You have not accepted him as the Messiah. John chapter 10 says, that, what does it say about the connection between the shepherd and his sheep? We talked about it last week. I forget, I wasn't around. But it talked about the shepherd and the sheep. The shepherd and the sheep. Understand, you know, sheep are animals. They're not incredibly bright. They're actually a bit dumb. So they need the shepherd. They depend upon the shepherd to help protect them and care for them. And it's the same with us and God. You know, compared to God, you know, we need help. We need him to take care of us. And Christ said, you are not my sheep, which means you don't belong to me. You haven't believed. You haven't accepted me as your Savior. He says, he continued, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. It's interesting thing about sheep. Imagine I'm a sheep. And there's a group of sheep over here. And if the two of us were in a place together and my sheep commingled with her, with the other group of sheep and got all mixed up, when it was time for me to go home with my sheep and I called my sheep, what do you think would happen? My sheep would follow me. Chris's sheep would follow him. Sheep are trained to hear their master's voice, the shepherd's voice. Isn't that interesting? How would that, can you imagine that? The sheep listen to their shepherd's voice. And it's the same with us and God. We are God's sheep. We hear his voice. Doesn't matter if we're deaf or hearing. Because we hear him in our heart. He speaks to us through the Spirit. So when I say we hear his voice, I don't mean we physically hear his voice. We hear his voice in our heart. He touches us in our heart, and we know to follow him. He leads us. Next slide. Christ said, I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Means they'll live forever. Not here, obviously, but in heaven. He said, no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all others. More powerful. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hands. Think about that. Just take a moment. Think about that. When you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are then and forevermore held in God's hand. That is amazing. So if you want to go to your notes for today, you can fill in the first couple blanks. The works. Oh, I'll wait. Everyone's writing. I'll wait till everyone's looking at me. I'll give you a moment. Ready? Everyone ready? Okay. The works of Jesus. Back up. I mean support, not literally a butt. Back up to. But they support the claims of Jesus. So Christ's actions and his speech, his teachings, align with one another. Us, not so much. We're not perfect. He was. Maybe we have a plan, but the execution, not so great. For example, 2 weeks ago, I had planned to be here on time. I had gotten on the road, I was driving, and all of a sudden, my car was not running correctly. And I thought, what's wrong? So I pulled over and I thought, well, what do I do? So I called church. The man from my hearing church was on his way home and he saw me and he turned around and pulled over and offered to help. And, you know, he was able to help me get my car running again so I could get back on the road. And I arrived here, but not on time. I was late. It happens. What are you going to do? But with Jesus, he never fails. He's perfect. If we read God's promises, we can know without hesitation that they will be made real, that God will keep his promises. So how is Christ's work evident in the world to us today? His creation. God created the heaven and the earth, and it's filled with his glory. It's beautiful. The Psalms declare that the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim his work, the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. Next slide, I think there's a little more. Psalm 53 says, only the fool says in his heart, there is no God. Wait a minute. Just pause, please. I struggle. So, God made the world and everything in it. I look around. Beautiful, it's amazing, wow, fantastic. But some people believe that the world and everything in it is a result of a big bang, a big explosion, and that in that moment everything came into existence. How does that happen? That everything can be made perfect. The stars, everything perfect through just an explosion. I have a tough time accepting that. Honestly, really, I believe in the creation story as it is written in God's word. I have faith in that story. But some people believe in Darwin's explanation of creation and scientific explanation, but they don't really jive with one another. The Bible says that God made creation, and it was a beautiful day. And we need to be thankful for the beautiful creation God made. He also made rain. He made cold weather. I'm not sure I like that very much, but he made it. And it's good. So God's works are visible, evident through his creation. Likewise, they're visible through Christ's miracles. Okay. Miracles. Now, God still does miracles? What do you think?
Yeah.
Yes? Yeah.
Yeah.
Does God, you know, strike us dumb, so to speak, you know? No. But he still heals people. It happens. It still happens. God still answers prayer.
Yeah.
Sure.
Right.
Absolutely. Praise God. That's correct. God shows himself through miracles. And finally, Christ shows himself through his resurrection. Again, we believe in the resurrection of Christ. We believe through faith. And we celebrate that resurrection at Easter time.
Right. He rose from the dead. He didn't die.
Christ died on the cross, and 3 days later, he was risen from the dead. Your next blank on your notes page, it's here on the screen. So unbelief is evidence that I don't belong to the Good Shepherd, to Christ. If we belong to Christ through faith, then if I don't believe, it's clear evidence that I don't belong to Christ. Now, I don't believe, I don't mean that you should never have doubts. I mean, everyone struggles sometimes. But what I'm saying is maybe you need to search your heart and be sure that you have accepted Christ. I can't tell you myself if you have accepted Christ or not. But I know for myself that I have accepted Christ. John continues to say that Christ said, I and the Father are one. And he continues, verses 31 and 32. Again, his Jewish opponents picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus said to them, I have shown you many good works from the Father. For which of these do you stone me? And the Jewish people said, we are not stoning you for any good work, they replied, but for blasphemy. Because you, a mere man, claim to be God. Was Jesus right? Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
He is God. He and God the Father are one. We believe that. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, I have said, you are gods? If he called them gods to whom the word of God came, and scripture cannot be set aside, what about the one whom the Father set apart as his very own and sent to save the world and sent into the world? That being Jesus, he was sent into the world by God. Why then do you accuse me of blasphemy because I said I am God's son? Do not believe me. unless I do the works of my Father. But if I do them, even though you do not believe me, believe the works that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father. Again, they, the Jews, tried to seize him, but he escaped their grasp. So, let me back up. Yeah, thank you. Could you just back up the slides for just a moment? Another one. Keep going. Keep going. Okay. Yep, that's the one I want. See here where it says, what about the one whom the Father set apart? Talk about that. I'm going to use a football example. I can't wait for the start of football season. One time I saw a team practicing. I forget who. It doesn't really matter who. The point is, it was a professional team. And they had two lines,
two different fields,
gotcha. On one field, most of them were practicing, throwing and defending. On the other field was the kicker. He was just alone on his own with two other people practicing kicking. You know, he'd kick it, somebody would retrieve the ball, they'd bring it back to him, he'd kick it again, way out. And he practiced kicking again and again and again. He just kept going and going and going. And I thought, that's boring. Who wants to watch a guy kick a ball all day? Whatever. Why? What was his purpose? The only time he comes, is called into the game, is when he needs to kick a ball over the field goal. That is his job. And thus, it was the only thing he needed to practice. He had been set aside for that one purpose. That was his only job on the team, was to kick a ball. He didn't play defense. He didn't throw the ball. He only kicked. That was it. That was his one and only job. Similarly, that is Christ's job. You know, the coach didn't come to him and say, hey, today do you want to practice receiving the ball? No. That was his one and only task, was to kick. Christ's one and only task was to die on the cross for the sins of the world. Christ did many other things during his life, it's true, but his one and only life goal that he was sent into the world for, that he was set apart to do, he was the only person in the history of the world that could do it, was to die on the cross. And Jesus knew it. Every day he knew that was the goal he was working toward. It was his unflinching task. That one thing. He knew every day he was a step closer. He knew God had set him apart for that purpose. He was like that kicker. He didn't need to train with the others. His one and only task was to atone for the sins of the world. Okay, yeah, if you could go back forward through the slides, for great. Okay, yeah, okay. So, Jesus then went back across the Jordan to the place where John had been baptizing in the early days, John the Baptist. And he stayed there. And many people came to him. They said, though John never performed a sign, never performed miracles, all that John said about this man was true. That shows that people were starting to believe. They were starting to figure it out for themselves who Jesus was. And John finishes saying, in that place, many believed in Jesus. They understood that Jesus' teachings, his talk, matched his walk. And they were convinced as to the truth of who he was. He was the Son of God. So what does that mean for us here today? Do you truly believe? Are you convinced that Jesus is the Savior, the Messiah? There are many verses throughout the Bible that prove the truth of that statement, that Jesus is God. If you believe, you belong to the Good Shepherd. Maybe you say, yep, I've accepted Christ. I know for sure. I believe. I have a question for you. If that's the case, does your talk match your actions? Are you walking the talk? Before I finished, I don't know, it's several years ago, I don't know. I'm old. It was a while ago. I was working a newspaper job.
Print shop?
Okay. I was working with a man, and he was a deacon in his church. And we would chat about church, Jesus, our faith. It was good. But later, I heard through the grapevine, someone else told me, you know, how gossip travels. We were standing around talking, and someone told me that that man, that deacon, I heard him say, we were standing around talking, and I heard him use a dirty word.
Joke.
Told a dirty joke.
Okay.
And I was troubled. It was kind of strange. It was not what I would expect from a deacon in the church. And, you know, it wasn't like, you know, no big deal joke. I mean, it was a seriously vulgar joke. Okay, so I'm not going to go any further explaining it. But again and again, many times, I was like, God was speaking to my heart, telling me as a reminder to myself that my speech and my actions need to match. And I encourage all of us to be mindful of that our life and our speech need to match. Our testimony needs to be righteous. We need to encourage each other in our testimony. And I could just go on and on, but let's go ahead and close in prayer. Father, thank you for your word that we learned today. Help us to really focus and be mindful of our actions and our speech and how they align with one another. And for anyone who hasn't yet accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, I pray that today will be the day that they decide.